If 12-volt compressor fridge freezers are so efficient, then why do you need such a big and heavy 100-amp-hour battery? That's a question I hear fairly often, and a lot of people still think they can get away with using an 18 or a 30-amp-hour battery. So today, I'm gonna do some really obvious comparisons between this tiny little 4-amp-hour battery and a standard 100-amp-hour deep cycle AGM. Now to start with, there's a few things you need to be aware of with 12-volt compressor fridges. When they initially start up, they draw a fair bit more power to cool down. Once they're cold and they're cycling on and off, they're not using as much power. Now the second thing to be aware of is that once your fridge is cold and your compressor cycles on and off, it might be using, say, 3 amps when the compressor's on, but it may only be on for 20 minutes of every hour. That's a third of an hour, so 3 amps becomes 1 amp hour. Now there are a couple of actions you can take to make your fridge run much more efficiently. Firstly, ensure that it keeps as cool as possible, so run it in the shade if you can. Number two, it needs good ventilation. So whether you've got it in the back of your vehicle while you're at camp or in a locked box in the back of your ute while you're driving, you need to ensure it can get a breeze and that cross ventilation through it, otherwise the compressor can overheat. And number three is you can insulate it even more by adding something like a fridge cover or a fridge bag to give it a bit of a helping hand. So let's see what happens when we try and power this 60 liter fridge off a tiny little 4-amp-hour battery. Right, so I'm plugging my fridge cord in and I'm using one with an Anderson style plug here, which means I can easily check how many amps the fridge is drawing. I've got a multimeter here so I can check my battery voltage. It's currently at just under 13 volts. Just to make it easy, I've got some alligator clips going onto these terminals with another quick connect plug. So that's fired straight up, sitting at 13 degrees. Now the compressor's just turned on. It's drawing a bit over 3 amps, about 3.5 amps at this point. We'll check the voltage. Voltage has dropped all the way down to about 12.1 volts. So it's really pulling a lot of power out of this battery. I'm gonna set that to 5 degrees and let it cool down. So that took about 20 minutes, but our fridge has reached 5 degrees and the compressor has turned off. So that's allowed that battery to recover a little bit. Now this isn't gonna be 100% accurate, but after another 5 minutes, it's showing about 12.5 volts at a resting voltage. So as a general idea of the battery's capacity, we're probably used about 30 or 40% of the total capacity already. So this fridge might turn back on one more time and you might keep it cold for about another hour at 5 degrees, but by that stage, this battery is absolutely empty and needs to be recharged. And just because I'm interested, I want to see just how efficient this fridge is. I'm going to try and run it off 3 9-volt batteries. Well, it's turned on. There you go. So the compressor has kicked on, which goes to show just how efficient these little compressor fridges are. But if you want to run this for any length of time, that's not going to cut it. Some people might think they can get away with using a small battery if they add a solar panel to their setup, which will counter any power used by the fridge. Now there's two problems with that. First of all, you've still only got a tiny bit of capacity. So once the sun goes down, or if you're in inclement weather, your fridge is gonna only run for an hour or two and then turn off. The second problem is that a small battery can only accept a tiny amount of charge. So you'd only be running a solar panel about this size. Now this little solar panel is only capable of putting out about 1 to 1.5 amps, which is exactly what this battery needs to safely charge. Now that will run your fridge and keep this battery fully topped up until, of course, the sun goes down. And that's why it's important that you have a bigger battery with more capacity. Righto, so let's scale this up to use a 100 amp hour battery. That means you've got about 50 usable amp hours before the battery needs to be recharged. So if your fridge on average uses about 1 amp hour, you've got 50 hours, or 2 full days and nights. So with this 100 amp hour battery, what's gonna happen if we connect that little solar panel that we're talking about before? Now in ideal conditions, it's gonna put enough charge into this battery to counteract the power that the fridge is using. So hypothetically, it's gonna stay fully charged. Again though, the problem is once the sun goes down, your battery capacity is gonna drop, and this little solar panel means it'll never catch up. Let's imagine the sun goes down at 6 p.m. and it comes back up at 6 a.m. But you camp near a tree line and the sun doesn't really hit your campsite until about 8 in the morning. By 8 a.m., your fridge has already used 14 amp hours of capacity. So once this little solar panel starts working again, you're already down to 86 amp hours. In ideal conditions, your solar panel will be able to supply enough to keep it at that level all day until the sun goes down again. The next morning, you wake up and your solar is now down to 72 amp hours. And this will continue for a couple of days until you reach that 50% capacity of your battery and it really needs to be charged back up. Now that situation is hypothetical and it implies that you've had your solar in ideal conditions pointed directly at the sun all day long. Now in the real world, as your solar heats up, or if it isn't pointed directly at the sun for every minute of every day, or even if a cloud passes over, it's gonna lose solar efficiency, which reduces that charge and brings your battery capacity down even further. And that's why it's so important to have a solar panel that is sized correctly. So as an example, a 160 watt solar panel connected to your 100 amp hour battery with a regulator is going to extend your camping time massively. But you still need to consider any poor weather. You need to consider the ideal solar panel angle and the panel temperature as they'll all affect the output. The other things to think about are what temperature you've set your fridge at, because that's going to affect how much power it uses, plus how hot it is, the ambient temperature, whether it's copping any direct sun, and even how many times you're opening your fridge. Plus, if you ever want to charge any phones or devices through a USB port or a 12 volt SIG socket, or you want to run camp lights, you've got to factor in that extra power draw as well. So you might be thinking, why can't I use a nice, inexpensive little battery like this with a bigger solar panel? And the problem is, as I said before, these little batteries will only accept around an amp or an amp and a half of charge before they get damaged. Bigger batteries like this 100 amp hour AGM can accept about 25 amps of charge, so they can accept heaps of solar power. So let's go back to the graph and compare our 160 watt solar panel to the little 20 watt solar panel. So again, we're gonna use ideal figures because it's so hard to predict what your solar panel will put out in the real world. This panel's capable of just over 9 amps of charge. So over the first day, your battery is fully charged. Overnight, it drops down to 86 amp hours, but as soon as the sun comes up, you're going to be getting around 9 amps of charge back into your battery. So over a 10 hour period, you could possibly put 90 amp hours back into your battery, more than enough to keep it fully topped up. So long as the weather stays good, you could repeat that every day. Now, as I've said, that graph is in ideal conditions. And of course, there's so many variables that'll affect your setup. But there's one final thing that's interesting to think about as well. And that is, charging an AGM battery like this is not 100% efficient. So a 100 amp hour battery like this may take between 110 and 130 amp hours to completely charge. There's one more additional fact in that. Between about 50 and 80% capacity, it's highly efficient at charging. But once you get closer to fully charged, not only does the charging current drop off substantially, but also for every 1 amp hour you're actually putting into the battery, it might only store half an amp hour. So it's something to consider. The higher you can keep your battery capacity, the better. That's why it's so important to have a good solar setup or a DC-DC charger that's keeping your battery as charged as possible. It's much easier to keep it charged than it is to try and charge it from 50 to 100% every time. And if you've got a battery monitor that tries to give you an estimated battery capacity, not charging it to 100% every time, or that inefficient charging that I was talking about before, can throw off the numbers, meaning you might think you've got a full battery, but it could actually be sitting somewhere near 90%. Now, the absolute final point that I want to reinforce, and I've said it before, is that AGM deep cycle batteries like this can only perform a certain number of cycles before they're used or dead. The thing is, if you keep them higher charged for their whole life, you'll get many, many more cycles out of them. If you used it all the way down to 10 or 20%, you might only get a couple of hundred cycles out of the battery. If you only discharge it to about 80% of its full capacity, you could get 12 to 1500 cycles. And if you can keep it right up around 100%, you can basically indefinitely use the battery. Now, of course, that's hard in the real world, but it reinforces that you should try and keep these as fully charged as possible for the maximum life. So, a 4 amp hour, 12 volt battery this size will easily run a 60 litre fridge freezer for a couple of hours maybe. Even if you're using a small or a big solar panel, it's not gonna work for that long. So what you need is a battery with a decent size or capacity and a decently big solar panel. In this case, bigger is better. So get the biggest battery and biggest solar panel you can afford or you can run with your setup. Now, I've gone over a lot of these concepts in some of my other 12 volt videos. Particularly, I've gone a bit in depth with some battery charging, whether it comes to temperature, cycles, and all that sort of thing. So I definitely recommend checking some of those out. Otherwise, if you're into anything four-wheel driving or camping, take a minute to check out the rest of the channel and hit like, subscribe. Make sure you drop comments in the comments below so I can answer any questions or any ideas for any further videos. Cheers, guys.